Good day to all of you. Today, we are taking up a topic which is a little out of the ordinary because not too many people give much significance or much importance to it. We will start with insecurities and we will lead on to anxiety because both these generally have a tendency to be interconnected. So, let's first understand insecurities. As I said, no, it's not a very, very common thing. Not too many people really give a thought to it. You'll hardly hear anybody saying things like, I feel insecure. People say, I feel anxious, I feel worried, I feel scared, I feel angry, all that they say. But very few times you will notice that people say that I feel insecure. Yet the fact is, insecurity, feeling of insecurity is a very, very real emotion and it can have a very deep impact on a person when the person feels insecure. Now, let us, pose a simple question to ourselves. There are people who don't know where their next meal is coming from and yet they feel a sort of secure. I will find somewhere or the other. Yeah, I still have time. I'm not hungry right now. By the time I get hungry, I'll find some means where I can get my meal. They're not insecure. There are people who may be having enough resources for meals for the next 1 year or 10 years and they feel insecure. What will happen after 10 years? If I run out of money or resources, how will it be? What if I lose my job? What happens if the landlord throws me out of the house? What happens if I have an accident? What will happen when I retire or when I'm too old to do something? Now, these are the factors which lead to a sense of insecurity. So the person actually starts getting insecure in the sense that, I am not secure. Insecure is the opposite of secure, right? What is secure? Secure is that I am bound by something. I have been held by something. So we say, that secure your seat belts, which means to say once you put the seat belt into position, you are now secure. You will not be thrown out of your seat. Stuff like that. Okay. So when you feel insecure, first thing is that I would tell you for yourself as well as for any of your friends and people whom you care for, please try and find out, become aware whenever you are feeling insecure. It could be something as simple as you are going to a new place or a new city. I don't know what type of people will be there. I don't know what is going to happen. So you start developing the anxiety and all that are there. As we have discussed earlier also, one can have at any given time, 1, 2, 3, 4 emotions. Our emotion need not be restricted only to one. So when somebody says that I'm scared, I'm going to this new city, I am feeling scared, fine. But along with feeling scared, are you feeling insecure? That I have not secured myself. Actually, my brother had said that he will come with me. If he had come, then I would have felt safe. But suddenly something has turned up and he said, no, I can't come. You go alone. Now I'm feeling insecure because that security of having my brother with me is not going to be there during this trip. Feeling insecure once in a while when you're doing something totally new or when you're expecting, something to go wrong where there is a real thing is fine. It's quite okay. And as I said, if you can identify that I'm feeling insecure, you can do something to secure yourself. If I am at home in the night alone and I'm feeling insecure, what do I do? I go and check all the doors and windows. If I have closed everything, I feel a little more secure, isn't it? Now, physically, nobody can enter into my house because I've bolted all the doors and windows and all the openings. So when you get this feeling of insecurity, actually when you identify it, it is good, because based on that, you can take action. But if you or anybody known to you seems to be having this feeling of insecurity every now and then, or sometimes even on a continuous basis, then definitely we need to do something about it. If it is circumstantial, because I am going to a new city, I am feeling insecure. I am starting a new job, or I am going to a new college or whatever, so I am feeling insecure. I don't know how the environment will be over there. So if I have something specific, a feeling of insecurity based on something which is real life, which is inexperienced, which is new for me, and if it passes off immediately after that, you know, threatening experience or incident is over, then nothing to worry about. In fact, it is good to have that feeling of insecurity, because like I gave the example of bolting the door, you will actually take action to secure yourself. Now, today I want to concentrate more on people who develop a feeling of continuous insecurity. Every now and then they are getting these thoughts that this is not okay, that is not okay. Will I be safe here? Will I be protected over there? For anything and everything, when they start feeling that way, then you know that it is very, very deep rooted. That is when you need to actually do something about it. The first step being find out where and how that feeling of insecurity was imbibed into you. It can be a simple thing like, when I was a small child, I went with my elders to some mela or some mall or some new place, and I suddenly realized that I have lost them. And I got very, very scared. I'm looking around, I'm screaming, I'm running, and I don't see my elders anywhere around. For a few minutes, I feel life has come to an end. I will die, somebody will kidnap me, I will be killed. When I start thinking of that, obviously the emotion is very, very strong. Then my elders spot me and they come, I go running, I jump into their lap, I cry, and they also reassure me and they say, okay, come on, you know, now we'll buy you some ice cream or chocolate or something, and they take me away, right? But that bad experience, which may have lasted all of few minutes, can shake me up. So if I have had 1, 2, 3, 4 such, you know, incidents in my life, particularly when I was most vulnerable, when I was innocent, when I did not feel I am in control of my life, I'm only a child, I have to depend on my elders. And if the elders are not there for me for whatever the reason, that insecurity can get deeply drilled into me. And that carries into adult life. The smallest thing happens. I'm staying with my near and dear in the home, and they all go out for some reason and I'm left alone. I start feeling insecure. It's my own home. It's safe, it is locked, but I still have a feeling of insecurity. So let us understand that insecurity, feeling of insecurity, is not so much to do with the physical part of it as it is to do with the mental part of it. Some other person may say, I was left alone in a strange city, in a strange house, where I didn't know anybody, but I didn't feel insecure. And people have their ways and means of dealing with it also. One of the simplest and commonest perhaps is faith in God. So person says, yes, I was alone. I didn't know anybody around me. There was a fear that somebody may break open and come in and I am left here very vulnerable. But I had faith in God. I prayed. And that sense of insecurity went away. So whatever are the ways and means, some people do work on it and it passes off. But my, you know, what do you say, focus is on people who carry it through into adult life and into later life. It almost like becomes part of them. Here again, I want to tell you that some of us have selective insecurity. Somebody feels insecure in money matters. Somebody feels insecure in health issues. Something may happen to my health. I've not been taking good care of it. I'm eating this, you know, unwanted food. I'm not exercising. So something may happen. So that is what I would call as selective insecurity. Financially, I'm okay, but health-wise, I'm not okay. Health-wise, I'm okay. Relationship-wise, I'm not okay. I know and I have come across so many people who are as competent, self-contained, mature adults. They have this great sense of insecurity. My spouse will leave me and go away. Now, what is the reality in that? Has your spouse threatened you? Is your spouse neglecting you? Is your spouse talking to other people saying that I don't want to be with this person? Then it's okay. There is a concrete reason for it. But if nothing like that has happened, I still feel my spouse will leave me and go away. That is what I keep telling is a deep-rooted thing. Maybe from childhood or whatever it is. And that's the reason why in the last few years, I also worked on this roots therapy, which I'm now giving out the soft copy free to any of our Banjarites, whoever is interested. They just have to email me and I've started sending it out. Let's see what sort of feedback I get, what sort of experiences people have. Based on that, maybe I'll be able to further fine tune it and make it into a good therapy, which basically primarily is based on, as I said, roots meaning my early years, my childhood, the place where I began my life from. So if you understand that this can be the thing, one thing you need to do is to build up certain assets which nobody can steal. I have some valuables in my house, I feel insecure that somebody may come and take it away. I have a vehicle and I'm insecure that somebody will come and damage it. I wear jewelry and I'm insecure that some pickpocket or thief can come and snatch my jewelry and run away with it. If you have these sort of feelings, even periodically, I would suggest you put your concentration and focus on assets which nobody can take away from you. Starting with the basic thing of knowledge, skills, building up your self-esteem. These things play a big role in negating or overriding your sense of insecurity. Now, if you are doing some sort of, exercise or you're wanting to work on this thing of insecurity, look into your early years, look into your lifestyle, look into the learning that you have had, look into the way you used to be compared or you compared with others, whether you had a protective environment, whether you were surrounded by people or even one or two significant adults who feel that, you know, they focus only on the negative. What if this happens? What if that happens? Now, if you're in the company of such people, you will also eventually start feeling insecure. And it also is to do with past beliefs. Do not trust strangers. Do not go alone. Do not do this. Do not do that. If that has been drilled into you, you feel that I'm helpless. I can't take care of myself. I can't protect myself. And therefore, I feel insecure. Now, the interesting thing why I combined these two factors in the topic of today is insecurity inevitably leads to anxiety. if I am feeling insecure, I don't have money, I don't have good health, I don't have people around me to protect me, I don't have a good house, I don't have this or that. If I am developing this strong and persistent insecurity, it leads to anxiety about the future. What is going to be happening? And the interesting thing is that we actually start nurturing self-defeating beliefs. No, even if I try this, I don't think anything great is going to come. I don't think I'm going to succeed. I don't think I'll get happiness. I don't think I will get this or that. And as many of you are aware, continuous trauma from early years in some form or the other, one after another, or even with gaps, in the extreme case, can lead to what behavioral scientists refer to as PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. The trauma is over. So we are talking about post-traumatic. After the trauma is over, my stress doesn't come down. And it remains at such a high level that it becomes a disorder. If I understand this, I will be able to deal with a lot of, you know, issues. Do not allow that these things to happen. Do not get influenced. And you know that today we are in this era of social media where so much of negativity is floating around. Somebody gets murdered in some remote town or village. Some elder person who is living alone has something. They start feeling insecure and the anxiety develops. The anxiety goes on, you know, increasing. I wasn't being able to see myself, so I was doubting whether I'm audible or not. Can somebody put on the chat box whether you can hear me? Even if you can't see me, it doesn't matter, but at least if you can hear me, I'll be happy. No, not getting anybody on the chat box commenting that they can hear me. Oh, yes. Thanks. So let me proceed. In fact, let me now go into the second part of it, which, as I told you, is anxiety. If I am developing anxiety, what do I do about it? How do I battle it? Because insecurity inevitably leads to anxiety about the future. What is going to happen? So the moment you understand, accept that I have developed a sense of insecurity, which is leading on to anxiety, which is leading on to a lot of disturbing emotions, I need to do something about the anxiety. So what I have done is that I have made out a few points in bullet form, which you can see here, Anis will show you, about what are the basic fundamental ways and means of reducing or overcoming anxiety. If we can practice those, they can be used as preventive also, and they can be used for when I actually develop high anxiety, how to get over it. Here you are. First one. Simple thing like deep breathing, abdominal breathing as they call it. Put one hand on your stomach and one hand on your chest and breathe deeply. See which hand moved more. If you are doing abdominal breathing, that means your anxiety level is high. You should be breathing from your lungs and your chest. Check it out and do more of breathing from your lungs. Try the same by breathing through your mouth. See if it makes a difference. They're very simple, very basic things, but people don't do it on a regular basis. You can do this thing called muscle tensing and relaxing. Your right hand and forearm, then your upper arm, then left, forehead, eyes, mouth, jaw, neck, shoulders. Each of your muscles, tighten them and relax them. Tighten them and relax. Tighten and hold for a few seconds and then relax. If you can, you know, tighten all your muscles at one time and then let go, that's even better. Simple exercise. Once or twice in a day. If your anxiety levels are high, do it 4-5 times in a day. The next one is identify your negative thoughts and write them down. When you see it in black and white in front of you, it makes a lot of difference. I am very anxious about my child's future. I am anxious about my job. I am anxious about my such and such relationship. If you just write it down, you see the effect of that. Anxiety has got a lot to do with self-esteem. If for any reason my self-esteem is low, I start feeling more and more vulnerable. I start feeling more and more insecure. And I feel that if a challenge comes, I will not be able to deal with it. So continuously build your self-esteem. How to do it? I'm not going to take your time today for doing it. We have done this on one of our Saturdays long back. And there's also a workbook on self-esteem, which I have made out. You can order it from Manjara, either the soft copy or hard copy, and you can do those exercises. Then the next thing is developing faith. You know, faith helps you to think beyond, to reduce your anxiety. It could be in the justice system. You remember that Jolly LLB movie in which the judge says, okay, people have so much faith in the judiciary that when they have a fight with somebody, somebody is oppressing them, they finally turn to them and say, I will see you in court. That's what the judge says. Saurabh Gupta. So the idea was, if you have a faith in the judiciary, if you have a faith in some authorities, if you have a faith in your elders, it helps you to control your anxiety. You don't feel helpless. It could be faith in God. It could be faith in your support system, and it can be faith in your own self. Do the simple exercise called thought stopping. This is something which I have again, you know, worked on it earlier, so I'm not going to spend too much time, but I have found it. I keep giving it to a lot of people whoever, you know, are stuck with some negative thoughts. Many of them have given feedback saying that it has helped them. You can also do it. And then there's a very simple thing called the worst case scenario. So when I'm feeling anxious or scared about something, I start visualizing what is the worst case scenario. I am sick. What is the worst that can happen? I will die. But then I have to die sometime or the other. So what am I getting worried about? I have a job, but I'm getting scared that I will lose my job. My boss is being horrible to me. Yes, what is the worst case scenario? My job will go. But then I will have to. In fact, by doing the worst case scenario, you know what happens is that you start preparing for the future. You become more proactive and more practical on looking towards the future, thereby, of course, reducing anxiety. Another simple technique is to give yourself positive affirmations. I am capable of handling this situation. I am capable of protecting myself. I can take care of my child. I am capable of earning my living even if this particular organization does not want me. All positive affirmations on a continuous basis. Remember, once, twice you do it, nothing happens. All these things that I'm telling you have to be done on a regular basis if you really want results. Okay, here's one more. List down your past achievements and how you overcame the hurdles. There was a time when I was facing a very tough exam. How did I finally overcome that? There was a time when my relationship seemed to be going bad. Today is much better. We have worked out on our relationship. There was a time when I was sick and I was feeling miserable. I had so much anxiety. What will happen? Will I develop some incurable disease? Will I die? But I'm alive now. In fact, I've overcome that disease. So make a list. All of us have these things called past achievements and how we have overcome the hurdles. Then get out of this habit of replaying the put-downers that you have been subjected to. People who have told you, you are incompetent, you are incapable, you cannot do this, you cannot do that. If you start doing that, you will understand the rationality, the reality, and you will develop independent thinking. Then, very important, I feel, keep company of positive and optimistic people. You cannot completely keep away from negative people. There will be people who subject you to what I just mentioned, put downers, meaning they put you down. They criticize you. They say negative things about you. They predict a bad future about you, your incapabilities. You can't stop them. You can minimize your contact, but they'll still be hanging around, let me tell you. So you counterbalance that by keeping the company of positive people, optimistic people. People who think positively, people who think in terms of, you know, the brighter things, that yes, things can go bad, things can go good. I feel things can go bad. And having tried out all these things, the last point, maybe the most significant point, is have long-term goals. Look at the broader picture. Look at your own life in a holistic manner. So many times our insecurities and our anxieties get compounded because we restrict our thinking only to the current situation, only to what we are experiencing right now, only to the hurdle that has come in front of me. All these things can be overcome if, whether you are feeling anxious or not, the last one is not to do with when you are feeling anxious or insecure. Do it on a regular basis. Once in a while, stop and think of long-term goals. What would you like to be doing? How life would be? The more you look at the broader picture, the more you go deeper into understanding yourself, your life, your relationships, your long-term issues, the less will be the impact of anything negative that is happening to you right now. And you will be able to handle it. I have seen many, many people succeeding with this thing. So it's entirely up to you. Take advantage of it. These are some very basic points which I have given you. There are so many more you can build up by yourself and work on yourself. Okay. So with that, can I take my 1 minute break? And here is Purni for you.
Good afternoon. How are you all? Somebody's caught in a traffic jam. has listening to Ali reduced your anxiety and your insecurity of not being able to listen to him? Yeah. So, Good afternoon, and I'll come on to this side. Wanted to share with you what happened last Saturday. You heard Ali out from this place called IAT, right? So what happened there was we had our annual day function of our Helping Hand volunteers. And I'm sure some of you all were there on that day. I think it was the most humbling experiences every time we have this annual day, you know, for me for sure. And I just spoke to a few others also who were not Helping Hand volunteers, but they were there on that day to help us. And then they mentioned, they told that, Purni, it was a very humbling experience to attend the Helping Hand annual day. We had volunteers who are all of 80 years old and going strong, full steam they are. And so many of them have done around 26 years of and more of voluntary services. You know, we had this young girl and we had this boy who came and told, "Sir, the years that you have done volunteering services, I was not even born." So I can imagine the number of years that you had done. I think it was a very humbling experience with all our volunteers. We were around 100 of us on that day. And all our volunteers were there. And such, heartwarming things happened. We all sat down for lunch. And then the caterers, there were two of them, they were kind of thinking, okay, how do we start? Where do we start? And suddenly we have a dozen volunteers. Fatafat, they're all there to serve and ensure that everybody is fed up properly, hot food. So I think it was a very good experience we had on that day. And when I was hearing Ali say that, you know, you should have a faith, say either, you know, in some people, in God or in some things, some actions of yours. And so if you have faith in relationships, and if you think that, yes, relationships can go a long way, but I really don't know how to work on it, what do I do? Then have you heard of that movie name, Main Hoon Na? Yeah. So I'm telling on behalf of Ali and our team, Main Hoon Na. So we are coming out with a 3 days residential, 2.5 days residential camp at Manthan. And the topic is relationships. So if you are from our side feeling any anxiety about relationships, how to maintain them, how to get them across, how to strengthen them, and I don't want to feel insecure about everything, I want to feel confident, then this is the answer for you. It is in February, but we are giving you advance notice so that you can plan everything and be there if you want to work on this aspect, you know, in your life. It's going to cover how to anticipate changes, what all changes that we can anticipate in the relationship world of ours, and how to also maintain emotional distance and boundaries. And last but surely not the least is, what is going to be the impact of social media on our relationships? So these are like mota-mota things that we will be covering. Ali is going to take us through this journey of understanding relationships, strengthening it, and making it an integral part in our lives, so that as much as possible, even good relationships can help us to work on our anxieties and insecurities. So if you now want to ask more questions, Ali is here for you. Over to Ali.
I'm back and I can already see some questions have come up, some comments have come up. The first one is from Roshan, who says, "Trying to make my daughter independent to the best of my ability, but she keeps feeling, what's going to happen when I am no more? how can I make her feel secure? The same things apply, Roshan, which I have been talking about, empowerment of the person. Build up her self-esteem and self-worth, that I am a capable person. Yes, I have a very loving, caring, protective mother, but that should be a bonus to me. That should not be a crutch without which I cannot walk. So simple activities, number one, to build up her own self-worth and her capabilities, positive affirmations, all the things which Anish showed you in the slide. Maybe again, at the end of the session, I'll request Anish to run through those points on the screen so that those of you who missed out can jot down those things or take a pick or whatever it is. But many of these things help. Now, what you need to do is to encourage your daughter and monitor her progress in developing that feeling of self-worth, self-security, and reducing the anxiety and saying, I am capable. Once she does that, she will be able to accept the inevitable, that today there is somebody, tomorrow somebody else may come. That's another thing. See, a person may have one person, like a mother, who is there as her anchor and who helps out. If I can understand that for any reason, if my mother is not available to me, I also have other people who care for me. Maybe not as much as my mother does, but even if it is half of that, it's good enough. Because by the time I'm more mature, more capable, and I will be able to look after my life. So it's a continuous process. We have to work on this and ensure that there is periodic progress. Yes, Roshan says, want to feel secure? Have a tall glass of faluda, which will make you feel very happy and cool. No anxiety whatsoever. Pamper yourself and make yourself happy in a safe place. A safe place can even be a restaurant where you go regularly, where the waiter smiles at you and where they get you this nice faluda that Roshan is talking about. Maybe somebody else likes to have a nice hot dosa. Maybe somebody likes to have a nice cup of Irani chai or whatever it is. But these are simple things which do help. They do develop your sense of security and they reduce anxiety. Alka says, I am in traffic jam with my husband and son, but listening to you, Ali, creating calmness and our complete thought shift happened. Wonderful, Alka. That's how it should be. I'm really happy that you are putting these things into practical use. My aim has always been that whatever we discuss in these Saturday sessions should actually be put into practice. So a simple thing like, you feel a little insecure or anxious that, this traffic jam, every time this is happening, when will I be able to reach? What happens if I get delayed to reach my destination? All those thoughts are coming. But if you start practicing some of these things, you will come. See, if you are going to be late, you're going to be late. If the traffic jam gets worse, it will get worse. There's nothing you can do. You do not have control over the traffic. There's nothing better that you can do. But you can create a warm atmosphere. You can put in your little bit. There's that very touching, video which had come on the TV long back. There's this huge traffic jam. Rain is coming and a tree has fallen down, blocking the whole road. And everybody's angry, everybody's impatient, and they're all blowing their horn and not knowing what to do. One little kid returning from school comes there. He's walking in the rain. He sees this huge tree and he starts pushing it. One small kid pushing a huge tree. Impossible, no? Nothing. He can't budge it one inch. But the moment people see that, something stirs in them. First, the other children in the vicinity, some urchins are sitting there, they come running and they start pushing. Then the other people come, then the policeman comes, then everybody else comes. And before you know it, the tree is pushed aside and gone. It's such a touching, small little video. We need to practice those things. Roshan also says, my quick solution is to give do thappa to the person who feels insecure. Once I did this to my daughter and she scored full marks in maths. Okay. I don't think other mothers would like to follow that example, but if it has worked for you, wonderful. Yeah, Madhavi says, I think when I was immature, I was very insecure, anxious. But as time is passing, I'm getting more matured and I've overcome my insecurity, working on my anxiety. Yes, I think you used a very good word there, Madhavi, maturity. The more mature you are. And what is maturity? Let us understand. Maturity is the ability to take control of your life. Not to pass the buck to anybody, but to say, I am responsible for everything that I do. If I develop that type of a feeling, then I will be able to handle a lot of things like Madhavi said. Kumar says, can you please give some tips on identifying time where one should take professional help on overcoming anxiety? Where how to make out someone is in really need of counseling or therapy? Because at thought level, we know things are going out of the way, but how can we see it or know it in our behavior? Kumar, the same principle applies for the mind as it applies for the body. There are people who develop fever, temperature, and they run to the doctor. There are people who develop temperature or fever and they say, I will take an off today, I will rest, I will drink a lot of fluids, I will take some grandmother's concoction and I will get well, isn't it? Both work. Both alternatives are available to everybody. But it depends on your metabolism, your thinking, your beliefs also to a great extent. So same thing applies. In fact, it applies more to the mind than to the body. So you need to decide. Now, as a counselor, what Kumar is asking is, how do I show to another person? What I normally do, a simplest thing is I tell them, the choice is yours. You want to go for counseling, therapy, or professional help, you go. You don't want to go, I am not going to persuade you. But you assess the damage. You see whether it is making you immobile or dysfunctional. You see the amount of emotional pain that you are going through. If you feel I can manage it, it will pass, I will overcome, and I'll move on to a better phase of life, I am happy for you. Anybody who overcomes emotional, mental trauma on his own is really somebody worth admiring. But if you're suffering, this is what I tell them. If you're suffering and your suffering has been going on for quite some time, I would be happy if I see your suffering come down. And one of the ways is that if you can seek professional or whatever friendly help from a counselor, a therapist, or whatever you want to call it. Alka says, good afternoon to Purni. Purni is already gone. Now, the thing is that when the mind gets very, very stressed out with the anxiety, that somebody was asking me yesterday itself, that when your anxiety levels go very high, she was telling me that these tips, I was just discussing these tips with her on reducing anxiety. She said that when the anxiety levels go so high, you literally, become numb. And you have no motivation left to even try any of those techniques. That is a classic example, which I want to tell Kumar, that I turned around and said, if you are not able to help yourself, you have to seek help from an external source. The same way as a person who decides, yes, I've got a little bit of fever. I have some grandma's concoction. I will take that. I will, have proper, very light food and some juices. I will take rest and I will not go out, for work and all that. And my fever will go away. But if it doesn't, if it increases, what do? You obviously go and take help from a doctor. The same principle applies over here. So if you find that you can take that list of pointers that I have given and work on it by yourself, nothing like it. And as I told you when I was reading out those pointers, many of them should be practiced on a regular basis, not when you are feeling insecure or anxious. That is when it may become very difficult because you've never done it and you have no motivation to do it because you're suffering from some major setback. That is what I want you to understand. Asha says, does physical work help in any way bringing down anxiety? See, I have been convinced since a very long time that there is a very strong mind-body connection. The mind controls the body to a great extent, but to quite an extent, the body controls the mind also. So if I am feeling down and out for whatever the reason, I'm feeling insecure, I'm feeling anxious, whatever it is happening, so my mind is disturbed, right? Now, what happens if I get into some form of physical activity, physical work, exercise, whatever it is? If the prime condition in this is that I should enjoy the work that I'm doing, if I force myself to go to a gym, or if I force myself to go walking, or I force myself to do some cleaning up of the house, no, then it will not reduce my anxiety. It may actually even increase it. So if I am doing something which I enjoy doing, on occasions like this, when you are feeling anxious, look for an activity which you enjoy doing. You are feeling anxious that your child has not come back, or your loved one has gone out and you don't know when that person will come, or something like that is happening. Now you have to sit here waiting for that person. Think of activity which you enjoy. If you enjoy preparing a good dish, or you enjoy, you know, making a nice hot cup of tea and drinking, or if you enjoy whatever the activity, you know, go into the garden and doing something with the plants. So look for physical activity which you enjoy doing. And if you do that, it will not take away your anxiety. Let me caution you on that. Don't expect that everything will be fine and all that. No, it will not happen that way. But it will definitely reduce the level of the insecurity or anxiety that you're feeling. So use it as a tool to at least, you know, reduce the impact of that emotional trauma that you are going through. And keep practicing. Keep looking for new and new ways. Okay. Asha is also asking, isn't it like buying time? Yes, it is. But as I said, no, you need to buy time. So your loved one has gone out, was supposed to be back, the person is late, and you're getting very anxious. What will happen if that person doesn't come? How will I take care of these? What will happen if this happens or that happens? All sorts of negative thoughts are happening, isn't it? And those negative thoughts can leave a long-term impact on you. Even after the person has come back safe and sound, you don't feel good enough because you've allowed your anxiety levels to go to such a high peak. So that is why you need to buy time sometimes. And when you do this practice of buying time, it becomes like a habit. And the more it becomes a habit, the easier it comes to you. That is how this whole system works. It is not very easy, as I keep reminding. Nothing of these things that we are discussing are easy. But if they were easy, we need not be here in this session discussing the issue at all, isn't it? It is difficult. If you are facing any of these things yourself, please start working on it right now. If your life is going peacefully, calmly, harmoniously, you don't have anything, please reach out to others. The best way to learn something is to teach somebody else, isn't it? So here I am. I am not suffering from insecurity or anxiety, but I will come across somebody who is going through that phase. What do? I help that person. I reach out to that person. I give tips to that person, and I monitor that person. And you see the impact when I see progress, even minor progress in that person, when I see that, it gives me not only a pleasure for myself, my thoughts, my positive thinking improves at that moment. And tomorrow, when I have to face a similar situation, I can handle it because I helped somebody else in handling it. So with this, I think we have come to the end of the questions. As I told you, we will not, you know, just extend this session just for the heck of it. Once we have, you know, dealt with all the doubts and comments and questions that have come in, we will close the session. Anis will now tell you the topic. She's already put it up. Making yourself complete from within. That is next Saturday, which is the 23rd of December. Making yourself complete from within. So that's the topic. And as I sign off, I will request Anis to just run through those same tips on anxiety, which you have seen earlier, so that if you feel like you can reflect on it or you can jot them down. Thank you and bye-bye.